Hachette Audio presents The Reverend's Wife, written by Kimberla Lawson Roby, read by Maria Howell.
To all of my readers everywhere, thank you for just being you. Thank you for everything. Chapter 1. Charlotte smiled at Cortina, the stepdaughter she once hated, and could hardly wait for her birthday guests to arrive. Cortina had turned 3 shortly after they'd moved into the new church, and today, here it was a whole year later in the middle of May, and her little princess was actually turning 4 already. Cortina was a big girl now, and Charlotte was glad she'd chosen the most adorable bright pink jean outfit, with cute little rhinestones forming a heart across the back of the jacket for her to wear. She was picture perfect and more beautiful than any child Charlotte could think of. She was as sweet as anyone could imagine and a joy to be around. She was the daughter Charlotte couldn't and wouldn't ever want to live without, no matter the circumstances. Charlotte scanned the pink, lavender, and white decorated family room in the lower level of the house and was satisfied with the way everything had turned out. The area was filled with tables adorned with festive tablecloths and a plethora of balloons, some held down by weights and others touching the high ceiling. The setting was just right, and there was no mistaking that Charlotte had spent weeks planning the biggest party Cortina had ever been given, and that Charlotte had enjoyed doing what she thought would make her daughter happy.
"So are you excited, sweetheart?" Curtis asked Cortina.
"Yep, and I can't wait for all my friends to get here."
"I'm sure," he said, hugging her at his waistside.
Charlotte studied her husband from head to toe. After all these years of being married to him, nearly 11 that is, Curtis was still as gorgeous as ever, and truthfully, was even better looking than when she'd met him. His skin remained flawless, his hair still held a soft wave, and even a person with poor eyesight could see how religiously he worked out. He was still the man of her dreams, the man she loved with all her heart, the man she was finally completely committed to, even if he refused to believe it. Yes, she'd made tons of mistakes, the most recent being last year when she'd slept with 2 different men, but she couldn't have been sorrier for her actions. She'd allowed her ill feelings toward Cortina, the child Curtis had conceived outside of their marriage and brought to live with them permanently, to get the best of her. But now she felt differently. Today, she had forgiven Curtis. And since Cortina's mother had passed away, she was honored to fill that role. It was true that for a while, she'd treated Cortina horribly and had wished she could move elsewhere, but soon Charlotte's heart had softened and she'd slowly become close to her. As time had continued, she'd come to love and cherish Cortina as if she were her own. Nonetheless, her new feelings toward Cortina hadn't made much of a difference to Curtis, and his plans hadn't changed. He was cordial and polite enough whenever he was around her, but he'd made his intentions very clear. He was still divorcing Charlotte as soon as Matthew headed to Harvard 3 months from now. He seemed so sure about it, like there was no way anything could change his mind, and this saddened Charlotte. It terrified her because she didn't know what she'd do without her husband. She had no idea how he could possibly expect her to go on, when as far as she was concerned, there was no life for her at all if it wasn't with him. But no matter what she said, no matter how hard she pleaded her case, he didn't seem to care one way or the other. He was quite set on his decision, content with it even, and all Charlotte could do now was pray for some sort of a miracle. She was hopeful that God would soon intervene and bring them back together again. Then there was her semi-strained relationship with Matthew, her handsome 6'2" and highly intelligent 18-year-old son, who had always been a very caring and forgiving child, but now couldn't seem to fully forgive his mother for the way she'd hurt him. Just thinking about that Tom character and how he'd forced her to meet him at a motel made her cringe, not to mention the sneaky way he'd tricked Matthew into driving miles to witness it. Matthew had even knocked on the door and caught her trying to get dressed. While this had all been Charlotte's fault, her sleeping with Tom, a man she'd never met, right after drinking too many Long Island iced teas at a jazz club outside of Chicago, and then being blackmailed by him, Tom's actions had still been downright dirty. They'd been deplorable at best, and it had taken her months to try to forget about him, months before she'd finally stopped toying with the idea of getting revenge.
"Agnes, thank you so much for all your help,"
Charlotte said to their longtime housekeeper. Thank you for everything.
Of course, I was glad to do it, especially for my little pumpkin, she said, smiling at Cortina.
Thank you, Miss Agnes.
You're quite welcome, sweetie. I'll bet you're going to get a lot of gifts, Cortina, Alicia said, standing close to her ex-husband, Philip, and Charlotte wished that witch hadn't even bothered coming. There was a time when Charlotte had loved her stepdaughter, Curtis's eldest child, and the one he'd had with his first wife. But now Charlotte couldn't stand her. Although it wasn't like it was Alicia's fault that things had turned ugly between them, it was Curtis's. Their falling out had occurred right after Curtis had given Alicia total control over his estate, should something happen to him, and just before Curtis had transferred all of his money into new accounts that didn't bear Charlotte's name. Some were now being jointly held with Alicia, and some were listed in his name only, and this angered Charlotte to no end. The only problem was, there wasn't a whole lot she could do about it. Not when Curtis had told her right from the beginning that if she caused any difficulties for him financially, he would have no problem releasing a few of those degrading photos of her that Tom had sent him. She also didn't complain because, in all fairness to Curtis, he wrote her a 5-figure check on the first of every month and had promised to do right by her when it was time for the divorce settlement. He'd told her how he didn't expect her normal way of living to change and that he would always honor the fact that she was his son's mother. We should take a couple of family photos, Matthew suggested. Curtis looked for a spot they could all stand in. I agree. How about outside? Richard said, pointing toward the sliding glass door. Richard was the hired photographer who had come highly recommended by multiple parents at Curtina's school, and Charlotte was glad she'd contacted him. Sounds good to me, Curtis said. Everyone, including Agnes, paraded through the lower level and out to the patio, and Richard positioned each of them.
I'm the smallest, so that's why I have to be in the front, Curtina announced proudly.
Maybe I should kneel down in front of you, Matthew said, teasing her.
No, Matt, then no one will be able to see me, and it's my birthday, remember?
Whatever, little girl, he said. Everyone laughed, but all Charlotte focused on was Curtis and how she wished she could do more than just stand beside him. What she longed for was his touch and the way he'd once held her all the time. She wanted this and so much more, and she was willing to do whatever it took to win him back. She would do anything to make him love and trust her again, and she prayed the opportunity would present itself before it was too late. Chapter 2. Curtis drove his black luxury SUV into the church parking lot, eased into his designated spot, and sat for a few minutes. They'd moved into the new building about a year ago, but Curtis was still in awe of all that God had blessed him and his congregation with. So much so, the thought of it all got him emotional. It sometimes made him cry like a baby with gladness. It was true that years ago, Curtis had been senior pastor of 2 very large congregations in the Chicago area, 2 churches he'd been ousted from because he hadn't been living the way God wanted him to. But having the first 2,000-seat sanctuary in a smaller city like Mitchell, Illinois, was a major accomplishment. Everyone in the area was impressed by Deliverance Outreach, and with how quickly its membership had grown. And Curtis was excited about the number of people who lived as much as an hour away, but still had no problem driving over to worship with them every Sunday. This kind of ministry and support was all that Curtis had prayed for, and he thanked God every day for all he'd done. Curtis left his vehicle and started toward the church. Once inside, he strolled down 2 different plush carpeted hallways and into his office. Lately, he'd been arriving earlier than normal on Sunday mornings, and while he told himself he was only doing it because he needed a bit of quiet time before delivering his sermon, deep down, he knew the real reason was because he didn't want to ride in the same car as Charlotte. When he'd first begun doing this a few months ago, Charlotte had highly objected to it, but Curtis had insisted this was best for everyone involved. He hadn't elaborated, although his thinking had been that it was better to drive separately since they'd be doing so permanently not very long from now. Curtis removed his navy blue suit jacket and sat down at his desk. He'd certainly loved the office he'd resided in at the old building too, but this one was on a whole other level. It was twice the size. It had a sitting area larger than some living rooms, and it was decorated with the most tasteful charcoal gray leather furniture. There was also a spacious bathroom connected to the office that housed a huge shower and double sinks.
And on the opposite side of the office was an attached conference room with multiple bookcases, a projection screen, and a classy mahogany table that seated 20. His suite had everything he could possibly want, and he was thankful. He thumbed through a few sermon documents and then glanced at his latest book, God's Favor and How to Accept It, which had just been released.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.